Good morning. So nice to see you all. And for those I have not yet greeted personally, welcome. It is just so wonderful to see you all here. I think in the days post-COVID, I will never again take for granted an opportunity to welcome people to the campus. Over the past few years, I've tried to use this speech as a time to share some trending observations about our students, with the hope that this partnership that we've built between parents and educators can continue. At last year's Family Weekend, those of you who were here will remember that my address focused on what we were seeing from students as we emerged from COVID. I appreciated the conversations that that speech catalyzed. So many of you reached out with your own perceptions and questions, and indeed, it has continued to be clear over the past year that our world has been fundamentally changed by the pandemic. As I noted last year, that's true for all of us, but it's doubly, triply true for today's teenagers. The percentage of their lives that has been impacted is far greater than the percentage of ours. And really, it is no secret that today's teenagers, on the whole, are struggling. The rise in mental health disorders, both here on campus and in the wider world, is so troubling. Here at SG, we have significantly expanded our counseling staff, and still, our counselors' schedules are booked to the max. Interestingly, and I think relatedly, we've also noticed a decrease in the ability of our students to navigate seemingly small hiccups in their lives. You know, things like roommate conflicts, homework struggles, poor or middling grades. The level of crisis that these bumps create is sometimes stunning. Dorm parents report that they are spending far more time helping students deal with these seemingly small and really developmentally appropriate, predictable events. Now, I say this with all absolute humility, because I've absolutely been too quick to solve problems for my own kids, but I worry that as a collective generation of parents with the very best of intentions and so much love, we have helped to create this circumstance. Today's teenagers are not particularly adept at managing bumps in the road. And I will add that I'm not sure that we as educators have been entirely helpful. We just need to look to the pandemic and the way that we were absolutely necessarily thrust into doing more for our students than we have in the past. We scurried behind them, wiping up every germ, creating protocols for really every encounter, out of deep and real concern for their and our physical safety. We kind of controlled their lives. Whether it's the pandemic or the mental health crisis, this all adds up to a really scary time to be a parent or an educator these days. Everywhere we turn, we see evidence of this adolescent mental health crisis. Both PBS and the New York Times have done recent series. Many of us come from communities that have had adolescent suicides, or worse, suicide clusters. When faced with a tearful phone call from our child, it's really hard not to go there. As a mom and as an educator, I know this and I've felt this. I think the situation is also made worse by the fact that we have far more data about our kids than previous generations. I would imagine that many of us, and I include myself here, text or speak with our kids every day. Maybe we track their locations on our phones. We know the grade they got on last week's test. And sometimes that's good. I love talking to my kids every day. But sometimes it means we step in more quickly than we should. My sense is that every single one of us had more independence when we were teenagers than our children do today. And undoubtedly, there were times we probably needed more oversight. We also learned how to problem solve. When our kids run into those issues, they call us or they text us, and we are always right there. And in fact, we already know where they are oftentimes because we can see it on our phones. And let me say again that we do this out of love. We do it because we have clear evidence that kids today are in danger. We do it because we know the implications, not only for their physical safety, but for their emotional well-being, sometimes their legal standing, their college prospects. And here's the crazy, crazy truth. Despite this oversight, on the whole, and by every measure, our kids are less happy and less safe. The dangers facing our adolescents are deeper than ever. As a strategy, our approach just isn't working. On the whole, I don't want to say that it's, and I don't want to dwell on the negative, so I'm gonna turn, because I do have some thoughts on what we do. Maria Trazzi is a psychologist in the Boston area who's often brought into schools or communities following the death of a student. A so-called grief specialist, she helps communities to navigate all the feelings that come following a tragedy. Years ago, I was an assistant principal at a big public high school in the Boston suburbs. In the days leading up to Thanksgiving, two young people in the community, a college freshman and an eighth grader, tragically took their own lives. Dr. Trozzi was one of the many people who came to help the community in the days that followed. And while she offered lots of immediate support for getting through those difficult days, she also provided some overall parenting advice that has always stuck with me. She argued that students need to experience what she called developmentally appropriate disasters. Her reasoning was that when the big one hits, when something happens, a tragedy happens, they need skills to draw on. What constitutes a developmentally appropriate disaster? For a five-year-old, it might mean not getting that extra cookie. For an eight-year-old, maybe they don't get invited to a birthday party. For a high schooler, perhaps it's a B-. Out of love, care, fear, we have done our very best to smooth out those bumps. We want to protect our students from anguish. We don't want them to be hurt. In the end, however, we just can't bubble wrap them. At some point, they're going to face pain. And if they've never had a chance to develop resilience, it's going to take its toll. A couple of weeks ago, we had a group of college admissions folks speak with our Board of Trustees about how we as a school could prepare our students for admission to the most selective colleges and universities. And they had tons of great advice. Continue with the academic innovation work of Justin Sorenzia and our faculty. Trust our college counselors. But the most poignant moment of the session came when the woman from Yale implored us not to coddle our kids. Colleges and universities are seeing the same thing. Kids who don't have the skills to manage issues on their own. All right. Again, I think I've mired ourselves too much in the depressing stuff. Interestingly, there is one place in this community where students have consistently had to take real responsibility, and that's Geronimo. When they are on board, they cook, they clean, they sail the boat, they fix the boat. It's no exaggeration to say that collectively they are responsible for the lives and well-being of the others on the crew. And you know what? They love it. Students consistently talk about their Geronimo experiences as the most rewarding of their lives. It's almost paradoxical. After trying to create a bump-free world for our kids, the experience they find most rewarding is the one where they have been given the most responsibility. Whether they are out to sea, when they are out to sea, we can't smooth the bumps. And here's the even crazier kicker. They don't even have their phones. They can't communicate with us. Without a doubt, I will say this as a parent, the period when my son was on Geronimo constituted the time in his life when I was least in touch with him. And I know he would say that those were the most rewarding of his high school career. makes you think. This summer, the leadership team was reflecting on some of these observations, and Mervin Osborne, Associate Head of School for Student Life, in his wonderful brilliance, noted that what we need here on the hilltop, and maybe in the world, is less cruise ship, more Geronimo. So, instead of providing students with metaphorical 24-hour buffets and nonstop entertainment, instead of serving as our kids' cruise directors, I was tempted to put a Julie McCoy comment in there, but I thought I might be aging myself. We need to step up and take responsibility. We need our kids to step up and take responsibility just like they do when they're on Geronimo. Less cruise ship, more Geronimo. I love for us all to think about how we can create these circumstances for our kids. How do you respond when they call about a situation at school? What do you do when they call about a disappointing grade? When they don't get the part they want in the play, or make the team, or their roommate said something that maybe it was mean, maybe it bummed them out, something that rubbed them wrong. On the cruise ship, we might jump in and try to fix the issue. On Geronimo, it's the crew's responsibility. For me, I've always said that my favorite moments when I'm teaching come when I realize that I can just back out of the room and everything would continue. As an English teacher, it almost always happens during a class discussion when students are fully engaged and when they're responding directly to one another and they've really forgotten I exist. In other classes, it might happen during a lab or a simulation or group work or a critique. And as any good teacher will tell you, it doesn't take less work to create those conditions. We have to put the building blocks in place, we have to nudge, we have to remind, we have to pull certain students aside and redirect their behavior. Sometimes we have to praise, sometimes we have to ignore. We have to ask the right questions. But when we can achieve those moments of independence, it's like nirvana. And I will tell you, I find it much harder to avoid the cruise director role as a parent. whether it's out of the very real fears I discussed earlier, or love, or just the joy I experience in doing things for my kids, I often do too much. And as I shared with you last year, when we do too much, the message to our teenagers is that they are incapable, that they can't be trusted, that we know best. They don't build the skills they need. It's going to take effort from all of us, both as educators and parents, to get off the cruise ship. Here on campus, we're trying to do more on that front. Our new Mission SG program requires students to participate in service, both here on campus and in the larger community. We're asking more of our students in terms of taking responsibility for their dorm chores and dorm spaces. And interestingly, it's become a bit of shorthand for us. Oh goodness, that was a little cruise ship. Or, we need some more Geronimo here. And I'd love it if I could ask for your cooperation in that endeavor. As the collective grown-ups in your children's lives, together we have the opportunity to raise tremendous adults. And the stakes are high, but I have such great faith in this community. As was the case last year, I hope today's talk sparks more conversation. I welcome opportunities to further this discussion, and for you to push back, and for you to ask questions and to talk about this, both amongst yourselves and with us. In the meantime, I'll hope you join me in considering this new rallying cry. So, in the words of Mervin, less cruise ship, more Geronimo. Thank you.